on a regional economic development basis, I'll talk a little bit more specifically about Lake Village County in a bit here, but to me, I think one of the, and it alludes to some of the things Jesse mentioned, one of the things that we gotta make sure in rural Minnesota is we're avoiding getting left behind in sort of the digital world. So much about economic development these days is about attracting talent and workforce to help our businesses grow and be able to meet the needs of their customers. And, you know, folks don't see broadband internet service as a luxury anymore. That's kind of an essential service when they're looking at a community they want to move to, they want to raise their kids in. It's doing things like homework, like Jesse mentioned. It's watching Netflix, as many people who don't have cable anymore. Those are the type of services they want in communities, and it's essential for our communities to have them to retain and attract people.
I'm Ann Tracy, and I take notes for the Blended on Broadband blog. Just collect your stories.
Thank you.
Gary?
I'm Gary with Public and Communications, and first, I guess I thank Tim for hosting this and Bill's work on this topic. I think the good thing to me is that this conversation has evolved. In the early days, we were trying to convince people it's important. It seemed like a lot of these meetings were about reaffirming that it's important, and we need to keep doing that, but I think now the conversation is more about how do you make it happen, and that's encouraging. You know, we have a lot of examples, and we'll talk later on the provider panel, but there's a lot of examples of how universal service is good for everyone, and that, you know, whether it was electricity and telephone in the old days, broadband today. So from a federal perspective, it's all, but to me, the solution lies within mechanisms that we know about, universal service and proper funding. And at the state level, which we'll talk about later as well, you know, the business model for broadband in the areas that still need it just really is tough. And so the state broadband grant program has been instrumental in moving the needle on those areas where, you know, if it was a for-profit venture, it'd happen, and it's not happening. So I'm glad we'll have this opportunity to talk about maybe both lenses, federally through universal service, the state level through the broadband grant program, and just keep moving the needle on infrastructure. You know, once you get the infrastructure built, then it's about affordability, and that's maybe a second conversation, but both are key to really universal service adoption and using of this, you know, key technology.
Thanks. I'm Tina Renmull with the City of Bedette. The things that are being mentioned, I think, are pretty universal in rural Minnesota. We're fortunate to have, I don't live in the city, and I think the city is fairly well connected as far as terms go these days, but very, very close to the outer edges, that is not the case. And we're fortunate enough to have access, maybe, but in most cases, we're paying for 1.5 and lucky if we get 0.3 or 0.4. Very easily, if we want to watch Netflix at our house, you start 2 days in advance to download the movie so you can watch it on Saturday, kind of a deal. People kind of joke about, well, geez, that's dial-up, and I would honestly take my dial-up back. It's frustrating at best. People that want to relocate there, you know, have to be able to work, and that's a lot of what we have in our community is people that lived in the metro for years, and now, you know, their job is a home-based job they can do from anywhere. Yeah, well, you can't do it from anywhere. And unfortunately, we're on the list of you can't do it from anywhere. And it's hard because of the gaps. You know, I think somebody mentioned earlier they want 8 to 10 houses per mile. That's not rural, especially not where we are. So 8 to 10 houses would be, like, pretty crowded. So
who'd want to live there?
Right. We'd have to move north. Wait, can't go any further north. But it's a struggle. I mean, it's a real something that really prevents us from bringing people in, and it prevents kids and others from being able to do those things without going to town to the library or staying after school.
Mark Klinkhammer from Garden Valley Telephone Company. We serve the area just west of here. Brian kind of alluded to it, and Gary to somewhat. You know, we have had good internet for quite a few years, and you really get to the point where you take it for granted. And I kind of equate it to electricity. You don't realize how much you use it until you don't have it. If it were taken away, or even if it's throttled down from 40 meg to 1.5 meg, you know, how much of a difference that would make in your life. And so I would just reiterate Gary's comments about how important it is. We're at the point now where it's very tough to reach areas that are left, and it's going to take a program like we had for telephone electricity to be able to get universal service throughout the country, I think.
Gene Curtis with Arvig, and you know, I can tell you that it's a hot topic with us as well. I know we focus on the unserved areas, but you know, we do a lot of upgrades to try to pick the speeds up in our area. We've taken advantage of the programs that are out there. So, you know, we realize that there is a return on the investment that I think we all kind of deal with a little bit. So having support and funding is very important to us, but we're willing. We're building as fast as we can. We're adding another 100 construction workers this year just to put fiber in the ground. So we're really focused and we're very caring about it. It's just that, you know, there are some limitations. That's just a fact.
Thank you.
Dave Engel with Greater Bemidji. I'm lucky to be in a region that probably has the best broadband service in the nation. And so with the all fiber network, and certainly here with Paul Morgan and Garden Valley as well, to our west. And so we're lucky. And so while other economic development folks are fighting to get what he was talking about, I get to go to the next level and talk about how do you attract companies, and how do you attract talent, and how do you attract IT type industry here to our community to take advantage of the infrastructure. And I like the fact that the narrative has changed quite a bit, and now it's about it's a right. It's a right, just, and it's as critical, quite honestly, as electricity is, roads are, any other infrastructure that we as a nation have invested so much in. So I'm glad to continue these conversations. I've been very lucky. Thank you.
Andy Martin, Senator Klobuchar's office. The senator's been has made broadband to underserved and unserved areas a priority for a number of years now, pretty much her whole term in the Senate. She's a leader on the bipartisan Senate Broadband Caucus, and you just mentioned infrastructure. There's been several letters recently on the infrastructure package that's being discussed, and the senator's called for, you know, a dedicated pot of money in that infrastructure package to be dedicated to broadband. And so we'll continue to work on that. It's kind of the timely news of the day from the federal side. So happy to be here.
I'm Andrew Gag with USDA Rural Development. Here to listen, don't really necessarily have a story, but obviously broadband is an important component to the current administration with our agency. So they're definitely looking at how to change the rules, things like that. How can they use the programs that are there, but maybe in different ways to assist broadband?
Brad, I'm the county commissioner in Monoma County. We share the same area as White Earth Reservation, because we're totally within the boundaries. I met with Jesse one time, and we're looking to whatever we can do to collaborate to get something established in our center, central part of Monoma County and the eastern part in my district. Like Jesse said, there are areas that don't even have telephone yet, and we need to work on that. And that's why I'm here today, is see what you can do to get this done. And we are served very well in the north end of the county with Garden Valley. You want to keep coming south.
We're working.
Appreciate that.
I'm Steve Howard. I'm the IT and Development Manager at Baldwin Communications, and I work on Gary's team. And we got a lot of successes. Like, if you look at the service area map of where we've rolled out big services and many other services, we've really grown aggressively as a company, and I'm quite proud of that. But we, as other organizations, face challenges. And, you know, I don't think over the long haul we'll be able to continue that rapid rate of growth like we have. Given some of the uncertainties in universal service, we as a company have gone out and borrowed money based on promises made by the federal government, specifically regarding universal service, and those promises have not been kept, and that creates concerns for us. An additional challenge I think that's going to face everyone is funding for the state's Border Broadband Grant Program. We have taken advantage of that program and expanded But we're probably getting to the point where we need to consider, you know, have we really gotten to all the places? As I go and look for where's our next grant going to be, where am I going to, or where's my team, where are we going to go and look to find the next area? It gets harder and harder with the 50% match. It's, you know, the good ones are taken. And it's getting more challenging. I think that percentage of match probably ought to be reevaluated. Maybe, you know, maybe it's 50% this year, 60% or 40% the following year, for a couple of years, 30%. Whatever some scheme is, but it'd be nice to have a long-term plan so we can build a real broadband network in really rural areas that fills in, so we don't end up with like a Swiss cheese kind of situation where we have this spot and this spot and this spot. And if you put in the hole, we never get service. And I don't want to see us there. Any questions about that kind of stuff? Talk to me afterwards.
Thank you.
Well, that list, I have two stories. One is personal business side. We do have a great internet service in this region. But as you guys know, 20 miles to the east of here, I have zero, nada. That's my personal story. That's a different, a whole different can of worms.
Yeah, that one is.
But, you know, down at the state, we've been, there was a group of us that really fought hard to get the funding level where it was. The problem is, you know, I think the Universal Service Fund, I think, is probably, if we don't get it there, and I disagree, it's not a right, it's a utility, just like electricity companies and all that, so be careful on your word there. But yeah, that's something that unfortunately I have no control over. The USF has definitely, I think, got to incorporate broadband. Part of the problem that I ran into last year, and I'm going to try to educate more people when I get down there, you guys know I've had 30-some years in the technology field. I'm very familiar with broadband and the uses and the struggles. They're down right there right now, they're pushing more of the satellite-based and fixed wireless, which, as you all know, for businesses, is not going to cut it. Even if you want to telecommute at home, that's not going to cut it. So we need a little bit of education, maybe some lobbying from you guys. You know, one of the comments that was made to me is that, you know, if you want to telecommute, all you have to do is forward the telephones to your cell phone. There's a problem if you don't. I don't know how many people here live in the woods, but even though I have a tower right down the road, the cell signal is not that great. So that we gotta work on that as well. I don't know how much more we're going to get, if any, this year, because, you know, we may be looking at a deficit. I'm not sure, but we've got 20 million versus, you know, there was a group of people that wanted zero. So we got to, it's a fight we're continuing to fight. So that's my story.
I'm Mark Jones. I'm executive director of the Minnesota Rural Health Association. And when we talk about health care, where healthcare is going is technology-based. We've got this big push for quality and value, and to keep you healthy in your life, keep you healthy in your home, and it's more than just clinical care that contributes to that. It's the education, access to all of these qualities of life, keep you healthy, and without the broadband, without connection, it's difficult. When we look at clinical care, we have the opportunity to go into people's homes to keep them healthy at home, to communicate with doctor's offices from homes. But that home has to be connected, and maybe it's not connected in the greater Lake of the Woods area. So it's a big topic for the Rural Health Association. It's one of those pieces that keeps our residents healthy.
Let's keep
your hand
on this. Almost every year, most years there is funding available. And I agree with Matt, it's not a rate. And if you go there, I think the only way to make that happen would be to have government paying all the bills. And if you know how government works, you know how disastrous that would be for our company. I will say that on a positive note, you know, nobody likes to hear the positive, but I think that our companies, especially our local companies, have made great strides, unbelievably great strides. If you look at what's being served now as opposed to what was being served even 5 years ago, and when we first started looking into this, one of the things that came to my attention was you're only going to build it so fast. And so we've been trying to get enough money in to keep up with how fast we can build it. there are areas where, you know, if you're, you know, I'm not too familiar with Baudette, I've been up there many times, but like central Monoman County, where you can go 10 miles with no one, and to start running fiber across that is somebody's got to pay for it. And that's where the problem is. And if you run, let's say there's five houses, it's another issue that came up. If you're running 10 miles to grab five houses, maybe only three of them want it. And so there's those issues. I do think you're going to see more money in the future. I don't know, again, about this year. It might be, it might not be. But I think that, I don't know, I just think the positive, we are getting there. And on the issue of wireless internet, you know, coming out of the satellites, Matt is right. That's a big push down there, because people who have it all, you know, that's all they know. I do think that is the future, but I think it's a distant future, and I don't really want to leave northern Minnesota behind until it gets here. The other issue that I have with people switching, you know, putting money into wireless right now, as far as federal or either federal or state money, is I don't, this is going to sound horrible to you guys, I don't want a bunch of people jumping on wireless and leaving our local companies behind, because we need those local companies to serve a lot of our senior citizens out here. They've, you know, with the fiber, I don't think you can beat it right now, but you know, we have to look out for that. If there is a switch, we want to make sure we don't dump a bunch of our folks over the edge on it. So, other than that, I wasn't even going to talk. I'm just here to listen, so I'll just.
Thank you, Steve. I want to turn it over to Bill, but I just have a couple real quick comments. And one is that there is coffee in the back, so we want this to be informal. If you want a cup of coffee, please get up and help yourself. And secondly, I wanted, because I neglected to mention that our two state senators from the area, Senator Paul Utke and Senator Justin Einkorn, both responded that they would love to be here, but they had conflicts. And so I just wanted you to know that it wasn't because they weren't interested. So with that, I'd like to introduce Bill Coleman. Most of you probably know Bill already, but Bill is a consultant with the Blandin Foundation. He works for the company Community Technology Advisors, and he can give us a little context as we talk about. First of all, thank you for all of that feedback. I think it's great to hear stories and personal stories, but Bill will give us more of a 30,000-foot overview of the broadband issue in Minnesota.
Good. Thanks so much. Thanks to Headwaters for hosting this event. Last time we were in Mora, we had about 60 people in the room, county commissioners and township officials, and then several legislators there as well. So that their five-county area, and when you look outside the city limits of those communities, is almost entirely unserved. And so that's a huge challenge for them. You know, they're just within spitting distance of the Twin Cities. About half the people in that region actually commute into the Twin Cities or into St. Cloud for work, and just the opportunity to telecommute for them would be fabulous, but they don't have the services that could meet the standard. One woman talked to a county commissioner, actually her husband works for U.S. Banks, in charge of their ATM network. When that network goes down, it's $45,000 a minute of lost revenue to U.S. Bank, and it's a 50-50 chance that his internet will be up when that network goes down. So it's a high-stress kind of activity for him. So just some fun facts on broadband. You know, this idea of what is broadband is now such an important issue that the FCC just recently reaffirmed that the definition of broadband now is 25 megabits down and 3 up. There was some push to lower that standard to 10 down and 1 up. And thankfully that was rejected by the FCC, as was the idea that a cell connection is equal to a landline connection. So those, from my point of view, very important. When 2008, the standard was less than 1 megabit. So you might have had broadband in 2008, but now, 8 years later, 25 megabits is the standard. So when people talk about high-speed broadband of 10 megabits, that's not high-speed broadband. It's not really even broadband service anymore. So it's really important to think about where people are on this. A company like Paul Bunyan increased their speeds 100-fold in that 8-year period. So they, government regulations, all they're stretching the companies. But if you look at the marketplace where people are connected is far outstripping the government standards. Comcast just announced that they increased everyone's speeds by 50 megabits. So if you had bought the 100 megabit package, now you get 150. And so the idea that we're, the people are at 1 or 2 or 5 or 10, it's just not keeping up with what's happening in the world. I was working with North Star Electric on one of their board retreat, and they're talking about the average family using about 250 gigabytes of data a month. And one of the board members says, oh, that can't be. And just unbelievable circumstance. A woman, one of the members there, her phone dinged. She looked at her text, and it was her cable company, and they just exceeded their 350 gigabyte monthly data cap. She goes, I just know there's 7 kids sitting on my couch right now doing this and looking at their devices and so on. So pretty amazing. And then the idea of what's a connected device. You know, it's much more than a cell phone or a laptop. It's things in your body, on your body, in your home. It's cows out in the barn. It's rain sensors out in the field. More and more devices happening. So this Internet of Things is really a driving force. Roberto Gallardo, who's a professor at Purdue, came up with this digital divide index. And it is a, you don't want to be dark colors in this. You want to be in the light colors.
Yep.
and so you think about the having a high digital divide index means you both have very limited connectivity, and you have older, poor people that are more likely to be unconnected to the internet. And so it's really showing now that the places that are unconnected is getting to be, they're getting older, getting poorer, and less economic growth. Whether that's causation or correlation or simply coincidence, people can decide. But the impact of that is that these are the places in the United States with the lowest digital divide index. Highly connected people, with people who are connecting. These are the people in the dark brown colors. Population loss, workforce loss. I've got another slide too that I left out, but the same pattern with business establishments and people who are self-employed, that people are moving to the areas where broadband is available. When people talk about broadband, you know, how good is your broadband? Most people say, oh, it's, you know, I got just download speed. But that's only one piece of that puzzle. And so the upload speed is really important. Some people say that download speed is consumption and upload speed is economic development, it's production. And so when people are creating music or architectural files or anything that creates these larger data files, that requires that upload speed to be effective. So that's really, really important. We had a banker last night, and architect, I think it was, or lawyer. But anyways, doesn't matter because it's every field. That he has two different offices in two different cities in East Central Minnesota, and their files don't reside in either office. They reside up in the cloud. And so this upload speed, when they switch a file, when they make changes, it's stored off-site. And so that upload speed is just an essential part of how they can do business. We talked about affordability a little bit. Certainly in Finland, of course, they're lefties, but they declared broadband is a human right. And many other countries have done that now. That people can't really participate in their society fully unless they have connections to be able to look at the news, to apply for a job, apply for any kind of government program. You know, I just applied for my pre-check thing for the airport. Go online. Well, if you don't, if you're not connected, you just can't even go to the pre-check kind of thing. The reliability is a huge issue now. the more people rely on the technology, build it into their systems, when it's down, it's a real struggle for them. And we're actually hearing from a lot of people in rural Minnesota that sometimes it's harder, it's worse to have, not have broadband. It's worse to have unreliable than no broadband at all. Because if you don't have broadband, then you make allowances. You figure out, okay, I need to go to town for this, to do this work, and you make the time allowances. If it's not there when you need it, it's a big issue. We know that the mobility is super important, and so as people say, is it fiber, is it wireless? It's both. And know that all that wireless technology relies on wires. And so if people here are on their wireless devices, that goes about a couple hundred feet, or less than that, if you're on the Wi-Fi in this building, or cellular to the closest tower, before it heads off to wherever that data is going to or coming from. When people talk about the 5G technology, oh, this is going to be great, it's gigabit wireless, know that you have to be within several hundred feet or 1,000 feet of that wireless access point. That's connected to fiber. And so it's the idea that, you know, a lot of people in Lincoln Woods County have a 1,000-foot driveway, you know what I mean? So it's need fiber down to the curb there, so on. And then latency, and that's the delay. So when we talk about satellites being the answer, there's a lot of things you can't do in a satellite because of the delay with that signal going up and down. It's hard to do Skype or FaceTime or connect to your bank. A lot of times for that bigger delay, that computer at the bank is saying, okay, where's your response? Oh, sorry, too slow, and they cut you off. So a lot of things that satellites don't work for. But know that all these technologies are getting better, faster, no doubt about it. This is the state broadband map, and red is unserved, and purple is served or is underserved, and green is served of at least 100 megabits per second. The state has two broadband goals. One is 2025 by 2022. I tend to ignore that one since that's the minimum standard of broadband. That doesn't seem like much of a goal for a state. It's 100 down and 20 up by 2026. And I like to, you know, trying to lose some weight, of course, in the new year. And I think, well, you know, I'm going to try and lose X number of pounds by Christmas. Well, I better have lost a lot of that by Thanksgiving, because you're not going to be able to get from where you are at Thanksgiving to where you want to be on New Year's Day. And that's the same thing with these broadband goals. There is no real path from 25 down and 3 up to 100 down and 20 up, because the 25-3 you can make with copper lines. The 100 down and 20 up, you're not going to make with copper lines. And so no matter what they're doing, that's just not going to work. So that's a statewide picture. And you can see in this region, there's a lot of green. Green is go, red is stop. So that's a real positive thing. This is where I was last night, and they feel the stop. In the town I was in last night for this meeting, looked like it's at a stop in terms of the business vitality and so on. This is your region here, and so you can see Lake of the Woods has significant issues, Manoamin County, in Hubbard County still, and so those are areas that need assistance. The beautiful thing about your region is that there are providers in the room. Even today, there's three providers that have been community partners. And so that's the biggest thing these days, is to have somebody who's interested in being your partner. Because there's hundreds of communities, there's 30, 40 counties that are looking for provider partners, and especially ones that are looking for this more comprehensive solution, not to go and pick up, you know, beautiful lakeshore, you know, spot with, you know, a bunch of Twin Cities seasonal people. It's who's here year-round, and who is it out on the farm, and who is it that we need to make sure can earn a living here and kids can go to school. So this comprehensive solution in these larger geographic projects, I think, are really important. know that all these technologies are getting better. I mentioned some of this before. When companies for a while were talking about 5G as the answer, I think a lot of us unified to shoot down that argument. Because in a lot of rural areas, as we drive around, some places you can't even keep a phone connection, much less a 3G or 4G connection. And these unlimited data plans that are advertised in large print all have asterisks that, oh, after X number of gigs, will slow you down, will cut you off, will charge you more per gig. And both of those are affected at the cellular and satellite level. I mentioned the latency and the delay on satellite. On the fixed wireless, you know, that is a different animal. You should not confuse fixed wireless with the satellite service or cellular coverage. There's places now in Minnesota that have fiber-fed to the towers, fixed wireless services that are delivering a 50 meg symmetrical service. And that is a pretty good service. It's pretty reliable, and it's not fiber to the home. But it's sometimes with those fiber networks that are in place to help support this fixed wireless can then be built upon to deliver more fiber to the home. So, but it's we are seeing big improvements there. But know that trees do eat wireless. So last night we had people from Pine County there. Their county's named after bandwidth eating trees, you know, so it's something that they have a lot to deal with there. Another thing that's going on now is something called Connect America Fund and the Alternative Connect America Fund improvements. And it's interesting, the CAF 2 program is for the largest companies, CenturyLink and Frontier, Windstream, and Consolidated Communications out of Mankato, not to be confused with Consolidated out of Brainerd. And then the ACAM program is for companies like Arvig and New Ulm and Blue Earth Valley Telephone in Minnesota. And these are two different approaches. For the bigger companies, they just get out cash, and they can use that for capital to build. They have to hit a certain number of households, and the CAF 2 is a 10 down, 1 up standard. Again, not even broadband according to the latest FCC definitions. The ACAM has a variety of different, is more of an operating subsidy over a period of a decade or so, a commitment of funds. And depending on the geography and the number of houses and so on, the standard is either 25-3, 10-1, or 4-1. It's interesting, there's just an article in a blog I always read called Pots and Pans by a pretty smart telecommunications consultant, and he was talking about the measurable difference in the way that the bigger companies are using CAF 2 compared to the way that the ACAM companies are using their funds, and that the more stronger approach is certainly by the ACAM providers, by those smaller, closer to home telecom companies, that they're building a network that can really be carry some bigger speeds. But the issue here on this is this distance chart, and this is the idea of copper. So all these companies are building fiber to the node networks, where they put electronics in at the county crossroads and reconnect all the old copper to these new electronics. And so copper can only carry signals so far, so fast. So by the time you get to 1 kilometer out, about 3,000 feet, you're just short of 30 megabits. By the time you get to 3 kilometers, which is about 2 miles, now you're down a little bit less than 10 megabits. And that's the federal FCC standard for the ACAM. There's some wizardry they can do here in this first kilometer, noise reduction stuff called vectoring, or if they have the copper pairs, extra ones, they can bond them together and get some higher speeds. But one of the biggest issues in rural Minnesota is the quality of the copper that's in there. It's 40 to 50 years old in many places and doesn't have, this is our lab conditions. So out in rural Lincoln the Woods County, that's a whole different type of laboratory of animals and weather and things like that. And so this is a real challenge
for how these networks are playing out. We had a, I'm gonna show, here we go. And so this is the two programs for, this is it. This is the CAP 2 map, which shows the green eligibles that are eligible for CenturyLink gets dollars in these areas for expansion. And then this is the ACAM map. And I'm less familiar with some of that. It's a lot more complex program, but there are some eligible areas here in this region. So that's something to look for. And one of the things that we have seen is places where those bigger companies have used the ACAM funds in combination with deed funds to improve broadband service to much higher levels than in that the ACAM or the CAF 2 would generally provide. But people, this is, I did just completed a study of looking at what ACAM or a CAF 2 brings to a community. And this is done in the Lindstrom area. And the blue circles represent 9,000 foot radius circles. And the red circles are the 3,000 foot radius circles. So inside the red, you can meet the 25-3. Inside the blue is 10-1. So if you look at that, you know, put that up and if I was a faster talker and a smoother guy, I'd say, that looks pretty darn good, problem solved in Lindstrom. So if you take away the blue circles, that's a place that meets the current state broadband standard in the Lindstrom Exchange. So no one's going to reach the state 2026 goal. In order to beat the 2026 circles, the red or the goal, the red circles would have to be everywhere in that area. And then this is a CenturyLink Exchange, Bram. They actually have some old equipment in there. I gave everyone the benefit of the doubt as I drove around and mapped out their equipment. So some of these things I think are duplicative, and I don't even know that they're actually live anymore. You know, they. But so this is their. You can see within the blue line there is the exchange. So fully a third of that exchange didn't get any improvements. And then when you go to the just the red circles, you can see how much of that area is covered with the 25-3. Steve?
Just going to add that you're also operating on the assumption that the fiber goes in a straight line. Clearly, it's following the road right of ways. So that is like the ultimate and best case scenario, and you're never going to get that in any of those examples. So
all my best technology friends have reminded me of that. So, and when I did the study, I thought, well, I am going to give these bigger providers the biggest benefit of the doubt. So it's really unassailable. I did send the study to those providers. I got kind of a snarky email back from CenturyLink says, why don't you go complain to the FCC, not complain about us, and we're not going to take any time to review this. And then CenturyLink, or Frontier, just didn't respond at all. So it, I think I did a pretty good job. I had a lot of different people look at the technology and so on. And even if I missed a DSLAM or two or five in this exchange, it doesn't really change the message that this is an area, there's people throughout this whole area. It's not like the wildlife refuge or something in that northeast part of that map. It's a real challenge. And as the people who might compete with them, like Paul Bunyan or Garden Valley, might come into an area and say, yeah, let's go serve this unserved area. You know, these boxes are all in the best part of that exchange. And so we've made this investment, whether it's a real positive or not. You know, it certainly is for these people now, today, because they went from nothing or a couple megs to 25. Or, you know, if you've got nothing, you know, 10 is pretty good. You know, it's almost like Oliver Twist. You know, could I have some more gruel? You know, it's just not a great deal. It's not great it's not great network planning. And so think about this, you know, is fiber a good investment? You know, it costs between $4,000 and $12,000 a house to build fiber to the home, depending on the area. know now that 70% of people won't buy a house unless it has a good broadband connection. That fiber connects home values by 3,000 to 7,000, or I've also seen by 3%. I suspect that the more a house costs, the connectivity becomes more and more important, because people who have the means are going to want to be connected. There's a lot of studies that show how much people save by having a good broadband connection. Just the other day, I was dueling a little bit with Anderson Windows on the patio door, and I called them and was very polite, and after that, I sent pictures and emailed and was very polite, and didn't get much of a response until I tagged them on Facebook that, you know, got the polite silent treatment from Anderson, at Anderson Corp. And 20 minutes later, I had saved $300. So it was an amazing deal. It's a lot of bandwidth that I just saved. And then that we know that there are people who are out there trying to make it work that are now paying $300, $400, $500, $600 for satellite connections, cellular connections. That's a lot more than a gigabit triple play service by the providers offering room. We also hear a lot about what the things cost and how expensive fiber is. These are a bunch of 10-year-old stuff I found on Craigslist for $10,000. You know, 18-foot plain lawn, a used lawn tractor, and a 2005 Ford truck. So, I mean, people are buying things, we're investing things. The fiber is a 30-year asset that's never going away in terms of that value over the next 30 years. It would enable 5G wireless. If you have fiber to the home, you can have 5G in your yard if that's something you would want. So these are my conclusions, that this region is better served, but knowing that the emphasis on making use of the broadband is an equally important thing in this region. So it's like my exercise bike in my basement. That's my broadband infrastructure. To get value on it, I actually have to get on it and pedal it, you know, once in a while. And that's the same thing. And we've recently featured Bemidji in a Blandon Foundation case study about five communities that are making great use of technology, where the idea of broadband, it's just like invisible. It is like air. It is like electricity. You don't think, oh, do I have enough electricity to plug in the toaster today? But that's how people live their lives now when their bandwidth are. We know, as Steve said, that the subsidies are required to spur the investment, that the Border-to-Border Fund is that tool, but no appropriation now. They received over $50 million in applications for their $20 million available. And I know that there is more than that in the pipeline that will be pursuing additional funds. One of the issues last year is that, you know, the legislature approved the funds in May, and then the application was kind of due just 90 days later. So it was a huge rush to try and get the projects done. We do have a new border-to-border rural broadband coalition. We hear sometimes that from the legislature, they don't hear about the broadband issue as much as they should. We think we're screaming at the top of our lungs. And I think part of it is our coalition, schools, healthcare, economic development, and so on. All those organizations, when push comes to shove in those last 72 hours, revert to their core, schools, healthcare. But it's really broadband. Every rural coalition should say, have a button that says, and broadband too. Because everyone's mission requires broadband. So Broadband Day on the Hill is April 12th. So I hope you guys can attend that. And so finally then, you know, what's good enough for a rural region is now really up to the leaders of the region to decide. You know, we've seen townships now bonding to partner with providers. In Chisago County, we've seen a couple examples of that. It's the biggest priority of the Minnesota Association of Townships now is rural broadband. And so we've seen those township officials stepping up, and I think we've seen a lot of counties step up and become engaged in those private-public partnerships that have been pretty effective. So it's really up to the leaders to decide. So that's my take on this, and I think Steve statewide, we see a huge emphasis on this, that it's really getting to be an essential, whether it's a utility or a right. You know, people see it as something that is pretty hard to make a living and live a full life without that connectivity these days. So thanks so much. So I appreciate that, your attention.
Thanks, Bill. Does anyone have questions for Bill before we move on? Well, let's spend a couple minutes with a couple of the local things. And Jesse, do you want to provide a little description of what's going on later?
Yep. Want to come up to the front there?
Sure. So to expound on what I mentioned about our main issue, we do have more than just one issue. We have departments who are running their organization off of the Verizon hotspot. We have multiple locations like that. And we've tried the satellite broadband and find that the Verizon hotspot works better. But location where we don't have phone service or broadband service, we have as well no cell phone service. So emergencies are basically somebody getting in their car and driving a couple miles down the road to get 911 on their cell phone. We are looking at multiple avenues. We've been working with tower companies to build towers in those spots. But from the travel perspective, that does take a little longer because you have people to be driving a lot and stuff. But overall, the driving forces and council, the governing body, receives requests and questions and needs from the constituents. And that's the driving force behind their action. And the action is right now at a point where we're trying to define what it is we can do. In the past, it's been a question for over a decade that I've been there. And thankfully, with Blandin and USDA, we were able to pursue a feasibility study. And from that, we have basically five main goals or areas that we're trying to explore. And the first one is does it make sense to basically become a provider to our constituents, a tribally owned telco. The second piece of that would be, can we go after ETC designation? Can we use a lifeline broadband provider on tribal lands? The other portion that they've identified is that we don't have interaction with our providers on the reservation within our borders. So they are studying the creation of a utility commission. And we do have health providers in the city's area coming back and forth. And telemedicine is an issue that we're exploring as well, because that's also, I believe that's also part of the USF. So it is, what can we do with the resources we have? USF is one of those. And the fifth part of that is our relationship with the providers, where it's at, what can we do, how do we come together, how do we work together. Out of this initiative that White Earth has actually, it's been a couple years, actually it's been on the table for a decade, but the last couple of years it's seen a lot of traction. As we have gone this route ourselves, we've found other voices in the community like Monongah County, the schools, you know, Head Starts. If you look at the tribe, it's basically a county. What they don't receive in funding that a county normally gets, they're subsidizing the rest of that funds that they receive from the casino. Coming together and utilizing resources schools, and the casino is helping that as well. We find that there's a collective group of people coming together, and we've had meetings. We've also had meetings with principals. Another avenue that we're exploring is the E-rate program in the schools. There's plenty of examples where communities have partnered with the E-rate program to put in infrastructure and bring broadband to a community through the E-rate program through the schools. So there's the council feels they have an obligation to explore all possibilities, and they've funded and gone after funding to go that direction. We've engaged a group that has a lot of experience with it. We've talked with a lot of groups. We've even talked with Madonna in the past. But I think, you know, the driving force for the council right now is the fact that it is the kids coming home and not being able to do homework. There are a lot of issues like economic development. That's huge. Broadband is a huge, and there's communities where they talk about the constituents getting broadband in and be able to start businesses online, and that's huge in a rural area to be able to conduct business online and bring income in that you otherwise never have access to. That's a big portion of what we're going after as well. So we're just in the beginning stages of it. I think the tower negotiations, looking at our options and what we can do ourselves, working with the community, and then working with the providers in our area, the council's taken a multi-pronged approach to try and get coverage into these areas. And so that's their point of view, and that's what they're pushing for. I think that going forward, they're willing to use resources to go down that direction, and they're open to anything at this point. So, I think that's about it, and I'm really looking forward to seeing if anybody has any questions.
So, what's the length of time you're kind of going to be studying this? Your feasibility study. What's the timeline on that?
Well, overall, there's been little work done, but they would like to wrap it up within the next 7, 8, 9 months. So based on the outcome, we kind of have a direction we'd like to go. There is stuff that can happen immediately. We do own some infrastructure in the area that's up in the air that we can put devices on. And in fact, there are locations that we did not have internet at, and we've run on our water towers to those locations to provide service as far as we can. It's not the perfect solution, but that's the job for now.
And Leech Lake also has some wireless services that they offer.
Yeah, they do, and I know that they're actually running phone over that, from what I understand. And they've been kind of doing that for, I would say, over 10 years. It's just been on a small scale, but they recently brought that into a better complex, I would say. Fond du Lac is running fiber to the home, which and I want to thank Bill, because when we first contacted Glenn, he gave us some pointers, and one of the things that he talked about was going out and needing a lot of these other organizations that are going forward and trying to reach the same goals as we are. So based on that advice, we did a lot when we met with people, and especially on the Black Forest Security Situation. So,
any other questions for Jesse?
Thank you. Jesse's point about partnerships, you know, if this is easy and profitable,
Gary and a couple of the other providers here were getting a room and kind of divvy up the map and figure out how they're gonna make money off of it. That's why we're talking about this, is we're at the point where these are hard to reach areas that are not profitable in a traditional business sense. So it's gonna take partnerships to make it happen. So I just wanna expand a little bit on kind of what I shared earlier about Lake and Woods County. About 16 months ago, the HRDC and Lake Woods County EDA entered into a staffing agreement, and so I provide staffing services for the EDA up in Lake Woods County, and pretty familiar with the area. But one of the first things I wanted to do up there upon staffing was get a sense of what people are feeling, what are the issues in the community, and the first one was that was a little bit surprising, but there's more jobs than people in Lake Woods County right now. I know we have sort of this perception that there's no jobs in rural Minnesota, and it's actually quite the opposite. Lake Woods County is a booming tourism industry. We've got about 300,000 people who visit annually, and that's providing jobs and everything from, things you think about, people operating hotels and stuff, but ice guides, cooks, restaurants, all the related services that serve those people. And then other things that are a little less expected, there's a pharmaceutical company up there called ANI, and they employ about 200 people, and they produce pharmaceuticals, everything from painkillers to hormones to a variety of different other things. And so they're trying to attract and retain everything up to castes. These are people who have certain expectations for the lifestyle that they want to live. And if the community can't provide those, they're going to miss out, and they're going to lose those people to places like Fargo, Minneapolis, Milwaukee, Chicago. So it really became, to me, pretty apparent that the number one problem up there, or issue to work on, was how do we attract, retain, and keep more people in the community? And there's a couple things we kind of came up with on how to do that. There's a different time for our legislative agenda, but one of those is child care. But broadband came up as a big issue. If you saw the map that Bill had up there earlier, basically outside the city limits of Bedette, it's underserved. And so working with Bill and the electric co-op there, we started with a survey just to really understand what are sort of the effects of this, who's being underserved, how is this creating issues with the local economy, quality of life, those sorts of things. And we had about 200 people respond to the survey, and then 1,000 people, that's not so bad. And you could see a couple things emerge, and one of them is, for lack of a better word, it's this northern Minnesota idea of expectations and lowered expectations. There was a couple comments I got, and it would be, well, how's your internet service? Poor, but it gets us by. Or, it really doesn't help. It's really not too good. But what do we expect? We're in Lake Woods County, and so I think that's a huge barrier to a lot of things in northern Minnesota. Is this level of expectations we have for ourselves. And especially when we think about our kids and the level of expectations they're going to have for what a community provides. So that's kind of an aside, but I thought it was a really interesting thing. And one of the issues when you do sort of qualitative surveys rather than quantifiable. Out of those 200 people, and that ranged from everybody all the way up on the lake to, sorry, I keep picking up the map over the back of me, but in the city of Bedette, you said the existing broadband goals are 20 down and 10 up. Was that
25 down and 3 up? And okay. 100 down and 20 up.
Okay, so the average broadband or internet speed in Lake Woods County, based on our survey, was 9 down and 0.9 up. But the challenge is, as you can see there, is you have this huge swath of land that's very, very lowly populated by density, and the existing providers, I feel, kind of take advantage of that. We talked to a resort owner who pays a premium to have his high-speed connection and has never come close to receiving those speeds. The challenge is, as a resort owner, his choices either have this poor internet that doesn't reach speeds I'm paying for, or no internet, which is obviously going to affect his marketing, his booking, these sorts of things. So. There's a lot of challenges. We talked about, I happened to meet two folks, I followed up with them. They are, Bill mentioned the U.S. Bank. It's a couple who just moved to Lake Woods County 5 years ago. One of them is a corporate attorney. And the other is does some financial management for a Fortune 500 company. And they're living right outside the city limits of Vedette. And recent infrastructure enhancements by Schoberg's up there has allowed them to continue doing what they're doing. They said it was a real challenge the first couple of years they were up there. And those are the kind of people in the community we're trying to attract and retain. So there was just a lot of kind of, nice stories that kind of connected why this is important. As far as next steps, it's really about engaging with those existing providers. We know it's going to take partnerships. As a county EDA, as a county, as a city, we don't want to go in business as a provider. That's not where we're looking. The question is, how can we help the providers? And I think that's next on our agenda. It's really about attract investment. We want to be your partner. We understand that these are profitable areas to serve, but in order for Lake of the Woods County to be successful in the future, we know it's going to take some partnerships. So that's kind of where we're at in our process, and I'll be listening intently to this, how to attract investment, because that's really what we're looking at.
Yeah, thanks. So, you know, it's interesting as a resorter, they actually, you know, have to run their business, all the bookkeeping and all the marketing, just externally focused. But then, can you imagine 4 o'clock, Lake of the Woods, the boats come in, there's 10 boats, there's 6 guys on a boat. They all, what do? When they, you know, they grab a beverage, I know, but then they pick up their devices. And how much work can they do between 4 o'clock and 5 o'clock or 5:30 to get caught back up? So people say, well, where have you been the last few days? You say, well, I've been working. Here's my trail of emails and work product. And that's a lot of bandwidth. When somebody, you know, opens up their device and all of a sudden now there's 200 emails times 60 with attachments and so on, that's a lot of bandwidth that's required. And then, of course, when somebody says, well, you know, bring the family up to the Lake of the Woods, now there's, you know, 1.5 devices per person there. And we've seen that, especially I've seen in the Brainerd Lakes area, where they have some good, pretty good broadband and the big resorts there, how important that connectivity is to those resorts. And I think that's kind of the expected experience now when people go to the North Woods. They think, oh, it'll be nice, sit up by the fire, but maybe yes, maybe no. And so that's such an important thing for this tourism-based industry that you have there.
I should add, and I didn't discover this during the survey, this happened in another conversation. So you've got 24 hours in a day. The average individual who's visiting Lake of the Woods is fishing 6.5 hours in that day. So, you know, you give them 8 hours of sleep, and that's a lot of other time that they could be using, as you said, to do something besides kick back some Coors Lights. it's definitely, and I should add, the other piece is we have sort of, based on the survey results, we did ask for location. We're kind of identifying some different spots, especially those that are closest to those served areas. We're saying, okay, here's some low-hanging fruit. How do we take this served area and connect it to this unserved area? And, you know, our idea is that we can kind of work, easiest to serve to hardest to serve. It's probably the best way to make some progress. Any questions on that?
Yeah.
When we first started talking about hosting this event, I asked Ryan to talk to a few people and invite them to come. And one of the responses we got from somebody up in Lake of the Woods County was, all we do is talk. And so, you know, in Bemidji I don't feel that way, but there are areas that feel that way because they've been frustrated with the fact that we talk and nothing seems to happen. Well, this is the time on the agenda that I think we start to address that, because I think the question that we want to have conversation about is, okay, what are some action steps? How do we go about attracting investment, and what are the companies that are doing the investment, what do they need, and how do we work together to actually get something done? We're really fortunate to have 3 of the really great providers in our area here to visit with us today and to start helping us discuss those questions. So I just want to, I'm not sure exactly what the format is, but if you guys...
they're going to come up.
Definitely come up, and Bill's got it all worked out. And we're just really interested in hearing from you about what it will take. What do you need from community partners to help your success?
Karen, do you want to just start and say a few words about Paul Bunyan?
Sure, I'd be happy to. You know, before I do that, I want to say how excited I am that Andy's here. I don't think there's a federal legislator that is more supportive, knowledgeable of our industry and these efforts than Senator Klobuchar. So, and I know Andy's a good conduit to the senator, and she's been fabulous, whether it's regulatory issues, whether it's improper uses of the network, or this issue about how do you get broadband to rural areas. Senator Klobuchar is just kind of a rock star at the federal level, and I'm glad she's our senator. And also, I'd like to thank both representatives for being here. Representative Green and Bliss, Representative Bliss actually, right out of the gate in his tenure down at the state, was going to bat for issues for us in terms of streamlining some of the taxation and regulatory issues that we have at the state level to actually build out things that were in the way of getting broadband investment made. So I appreciate that early support of yours. But a little bit about Paul Bunyan. So we're a cooperative. We were formed in 1952, so we've been at this a while. Certainly on the voice side, and now it's, as you know, all about broadband. Talk about fiber the premise. We, since 2004, that's all we've installed. So it's all the conversation today. But the reason we have 6,000 square miles that's fiber the premise, or nearly, is the fact that we started in 2004, building and investing to do that. And I'm glad we have representatives from the USDA Rural Development here, because we have invested nearly $150 million since 2004 to do this. And a big part of it, in fact, we got one loan that was $65 million or so through rural development to enable us to upgrade our some of our most rural areas to fiber the prem. So it takes time, it takes effort, it takes creative programs like the Rural Broadband Loan Program to make this happen. All those things have culminated in the fact that now we have gigabit across that whole, virtually that whole footprint that we're talking about. And, you know, Bill talked about download speeds and upload speeds. He's spot on when he talks about the importance of upload speeds in terms of economic development, innovation. It really takes that two-way network. And it'll be a fun, I think Representative Green pointed out that the conversation now, especially at the state level, about wireless versus fiber versus, you know, these technology decisions. And to me, it couldn't be more simple. But I know it's a complex topic. But if you look at making investments, whether it's through USDA with these loans that we've been paying back now for decades, or it's through the state broadband grant program, to me, it's clear these investments need to be long-term. It's the path we've chosen. It's why we're doing fiber gigabit everywhere. It wasn't the cheapest, it wasn't the easiest, but it's the one that's going to be there for decades. And when you're putting something in the ground that's going to be there for 30, 40, maybe 50 years, I can't imagine why we would be contemplating anything that's less than a future-proof, future-oriented network technology. Wireless,